Cause that's the bottom line.
Greetings, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Monday, June 27th edition of the Bottom Line Lexington Podcast. Summertime in full effect here in Central Kentucky. Late June, 90 plus degree temperatures. Lexington still abuzz over the NBA draft late last week, in which three Kentucky players were drafted. Jamal Murray went 7th, Scalabissiere went 28th, and Tyler Ulis went in the 2nd round. Mark Story had an article in the Lexington paper today on 5 players who misjudged their draft position. And he listed Alex Poitras, which I disagree with, Scalabissiere, which I disagree with, and Dakari Johnson, which I do agree with, actually, as some of those players that misjudged their draft stock. When you look at players who turn pro, did they turn pro at the right time? Did they not turn pro at the right time? It's all about the bottom line. Because that's what we're about here on this show, the bottom line. Did you go in the first round? That's all that matters. Did you go in the first round? People are like, oh, Scal made a huge mistake. He should have stayed in school. He went in the first round. He got his guaranteed money. If he had come back to Kentucky, he would have been exposed for the fraud that he is. I'm sorry. If you're an NBA team, how can you take a guy who averaged 6 points and 6 rebounds a game last year in the lottery? That's what I don't understand. People around here, oh, these teams will pay for passing on Scal. He wasn't even playing for Kentucky in crunch time of big games last year in college. What makes you think he should be a lottery pick in the NBA? Absolutely ridiculous logic. Scal should be lucky that he got drafted in the first round because based on his college performance, he did not deserve to go in the first round. Heck, he didn't deserve to get drafted. But when it comes right down to it, Scal made the right decision to turn pro because eventually he did get drafted in the first round. And that's more than you could ask for going in the first round. Who made a mistake? Tyler Ulis made a mistake going pro. Oh, but he went to Phoenix and Devin Booker is there and all the other UK guys are there. Who cares? He gets no guaranteed money. He may start the season on the Phoenix Suns. He may start the season in the D League, which is where I think he'll be playing next year. So Tyler Ulis ends up just like the Harrison Twins, just like Dakari Johnson, just like those guys that turn pro and don't get drafted in the first round. They go into oblivion and you never hear from them again. Top of your head, what team did Dakari Johnson play for last year? Exactly. More things I disagree with this Mark Story article on. He said Daniel Orton misjudged his draft stock. He averaged 3 points and 3 rebounds a game at Kentucky. That's exactly half less than Scal did. And he was still drafted in the first round. How did he misjudge his draft stock? He went in the first round and was even worse than Scal. He played 41 games in the NBA. That's 41 more than he should have played. I think he judged his draft stock perfectly. Because if he had gone back to Kentucky, he gets exposed as what he really is. If you could play in the NBA, they'll put you out there, no matter where you're drafted. Story also said Marcus Teague misjudged his draft spot. Teague averaged 10 points and 4 assists a game with Kentucky, but he got drafted in the first round. That's all that matters. He played 40 games in the NBA. Played well in the D League last year, but he's not going to get back to the NBA. He got 40 games in the league, and they said, you're not good enough. Bottom line on this, if you go in the first round, you made the right move in going pro. No matter where you go, if you go first, if you go 30th, you made the right move, period. No matter who you are. If you go in the first pick of the 2nd round, you made a mistake. Tyler Ulis, who Rex Chapman came out and said was the best point guard in the draft. Don't get me started on Rex Chapman these days, but I digress. Tyler Ulis made a mistake going pro. He got drafted in the 2nd round. He gets no guaranteed money. He'll be playing in the D League next year. Big mistake. Big news in Cincinnati this weekend. Pete Rose was inducted into the Reds Hall of Fame, not the Major League Baseball Hall of Fame. And they had a big ceremony the entire weekend to celebrate it. Now, for my money, I think the Reds looked at their team and said, wow, we're going to be lousy. And then said, hey, what weekend are we probably going to get the fewest fans in the seats? Oh, we play the also lousy Padres in a 4-game series at the end of June. There's the ticket right there. Let's make a Pete Rose weekend that weekend because we're not going to get any fans anyway. Brilliant marketing. So the Reds trot out Pete, and they trot out all the old big red machine from the 70s, except for Joe Morgan, who's apparently sick. They even trotted out my first favorite player, George Foster, who still looks as scary as ever. And Pete dyes his hair jet black. By the way, did you see Pete without that white hat all weekend? I want to see the inside of that white hat because I guarantee you there's enough Just for Men hair coloring product on the inside of his hat that hat should be turning black anytime now. But Pete goes into the Hall of Fame. God bless him. He's had a tough life after baseball, after being suspended with the lies and the gambling and the blah, blah, blah. He'll never get into the real Hall of Fame, so this is as close as he'll ever get. On the overnight ESPN Sports Center, they didn't even show highlights of the Reds game. They showed Pete getting his little plaque or whatever for going into the Hall of Fame. And they said, oh, by the way, the Reds win 3-0. On to more highlights. Boy, times have changed on ESPN. You don't see a whole lot of baseball highlights anymore. When I was a kid, in the summertime, they started with baseball, they ended with baseball, and they showed highlights of every game. They don't do that now. I saw as much soccer and WNBA as I did baseball highlights overnight. Unbelievable. Speaking of the Reds, they did win 3-0 yesterday to salvage. By the way, how many times do you hear the word salvage used in real life other than when a team salvages the last game of a 3-game series or a 4-game series? So the Reds salvaged the last of the 4-game series against the Padres. Anthony DeSclafani, now 2-0, 1.52 ERA. Easily the best pitcher for the Reds so far, but he's only pitched, but he hasn't pitched much due to injury. Richard Skinner of WKRC, not WKRP in Cincinnati, that would be Dr. Johnny Fever, wrote a column over the weekend talking about Zach Cozart and Jay Bruce and how they'll be trade bait for the upcoming trade deadline July 31st. And even over the weekend, ESPN was reporting that the Dodgers were asking the Reds about Jay Bruce. And after watching the Dodgers blow a game to the Pirates on Sunday night, I can see why they need a good left-handed bat, especially out in right field. But the Reds really have two guys that they could trade. Cozart and Bruce. And Bruce is hitting .279, 17 home runs, 58 RBIs, easily his best season to date, OPS over 900, and Jay Bruce still only 29 years old. It seems like he's been around for a long time. He has, but he got started early. He's due to make $13 million next year, or if the Reds still have him, they can just give him $1 million and send him walking, which they won't do because they'll trade him first. Bruce on pace for 36 home runs. These are career high numbers for him. If you're going to trade him, trade him now. What are you waiting for? The inevitable slump that's coming? Jay Bruce was a key player on the Reds playoff teams earlier this decade, but this team isn't going to the playoffs anytime soon. And the next time they go to the playoffs, Jay Bruce will not be on this team. Dump him. And speaking of guys they should dump, Zach Cozart, who on this show we have begged people for the last month and a half, jump off this guy's bandwagon. He started so well this year. Zach Cozart hit .361 in April. Oh, he's back. Oh, this is going to be his best year. We kept going back to his career stats with over 2,000 at-bats and under a .250 career average and saying, there's no way this continues. So after that .361 average in April, in May he hit .247. In June, he's hitting .228. Regression to the mean. We predicted it many times on this show. We begged fantasy owners, get off that Zach Cozart bandwagon. The time to sell him was the first day of May. Zach Cozart's 31 years old. He's older than Jay Bruce. You wouldn't think so, because Cozart hasn't been around nearly as long. And yes, if you trade Cozart, who are you going to put at shortstop? Suarez and his iron skillet glove? No thanks. But he's arbitration eligible after this year. He's going to get more money than he deserves. So yes, you trade him. Zach Cozart is a career .248 hitter. He's not going to hit over .300. Sorry, he's not. One guy who the Reds won't be trading, that apparently people are wondering when he's going to be traded, is Adam Duvall. He of the 21 home runs, on pace for 45 home runs this season. The Reds will not trade him anytime soon. Is it because he's such a great hitter? No. He's only hitting .252. And his on-base percentage is under .290. By the way, the league average on-base percentage, about .333. And he's on pace to strike out close to 200 times this year. If you wanted Adam Dunn from a few years ago, you've got the right-handed version of that this year in Adam Duvall. Lots of home runs, lots of strikeouts, poor batting average. Congratulations. But they won't be trading Duvall. He's under club control for another 4 to 5 years. So why would they give up on this guy? So yes, Cozart and Bruce will be and should be gone next month. Duvall will stick around. As for the Reds, 29-47 now. Their next 13 games, 6 are against the Cubs, 4 against the Nationals, 3 against the Marlins. If the season ended today, all 3 of those teams would be playoff teams. Good luck finishing the first half of the season on a high note. Thinking of those Cubs, Cubs and Reds tonight at Great America Ballpark. Jake Arrieta for the Cubs, 11-2, 1.74 against Dan Straley, part of the Finnegan, Straley, and Pray for Rain daily rotation for the Reds. 3.83, Cubs minus 225 this morning. And we always say there's no way you take a baseball favorite at minus 225 ever under any circumstance. The last time Arrieta pitched in Cincinnati, he won that game 16-0. Reds still 18-22 at home. They're not terrible. They're not great, but they're not terrible at home. You either take the Reds or nobody in this game, but you're getting a lot of value at plus over 200 with the Reds. So if you're playing it, it's either the Reds or nobody. I'll take nobody, but I don't fault you for putting a couple of dollars on the Reds and hoping to hit the lottery. Heard a lot of stuff this weekend about the Reds 1976 team being the best team of all time. And yes, you had 4 Hall of Fame players on that team. Rose, Bench, Morgan, Perez. You had a guy who would go on to hit 50-plus home runs in a season in an era when nobody hit 50-plus home runs in a season. George Foster in 1977. You had Ken Griffey Sr. You had Dave Concepcion. But quick, name one pitcher. Exactly. That's why they're not the greatest team of all time. Jerry Tipton, who we absolutely love on this show because he gives us a lot of comic relief, wins the Captain Obvious Award for this weekend, coming out and saying Marcus Lee, his transfer to Cal, was not because of playing time, but just because he wanted to go home. Ladies and gentlemen, it's late June in Lexington, Kentucky. It's Fluff Piece Central at the Lexington Herald Leader. I'm just telling you. If you believe that, I'm serious. If you believe that crap, then you've lost your mind. Oh, but if it's in the paper, if it's in the Lexington paper, it's gotta be true. That's the kind of mentality that kills me. Jerry Tipton could write anything, and usually does, as crazy as he's been, and people will believe it. If you honestly believe Marcus Lee transferred to California just to be closer to home and not because of playing time he would get next year at UK, then you'll believe anything. More baseball. When I say the name A.J. Reed, what comes to mind? In the state of Kentucky, some people remember him as being the National Player of the Year at the University of Kentucky in baseball 2 years ago. Most people don't have a clue who he is. Well, he's already made the major leagues, and in 2 games, Saturday and Sunday, he went 0-for-5 with an RBI. He went 0-for-3 Sunday with 3 strikeouts, but hey, it's his second game. Cut the kid a break. But the point is, if I say the name A.J. Reed to people in Kentucky, most of them have no idea who I'm talking about. If I say Sam Malone, if I say any name of any kid that sat on the end of the UK basketball bench, they all know who he is. That's life in Kentucky. But A.J. Reed, a highly touted prospect, already in the majors with Houston. Fox's Clay Travis came out after the draft last weekend and said a few disparaging things about your beloved coach Calipari. And I'm just going to read this quote. This isn't me. This is Clay Travis of Fox Sports. And this is what he said about Coach Cal. Let's be honest. Cal is paying players and has been for years. It would be the biggest upset in the history of mankind for him not to be doing that. It's laughable to assume he's not paying those players. I think Cal cheats his ass off. If he wrote a tell-all book, it would be a bestseller, and it would be about how to get guys in to school with bad test scores and how to get grades changed once they get to school. I always liked Clay Travis. I always thought he was spot on about a lot of things. About 7 years ago, Clay Travis once said DeMarcus Cousins would be in jail within 5 years. It's been 7 years. Now, Cousins has done some crazy things, but he's not in jail, at least not yet. So there's obviously an axe to grind between Clay Travis and Coach Calipari. Do I think Cal cheats? Yeah, I think he cheats. Then again, I think everybody cheats. It's all about how much you can get away with. Cal's figured it out. I don't disagree with Clay Travis. I just don't think you could pinpoint Cal as the only guy doing it. It's summertime, so ESPN looking for content, looking for clicks on their college sports sites. came up with a dream sequence, kind of a fantasy league, in which they took college basketball teams from a three-year window of everyone who played at that school and said who would be the best teams if everybody had to stay for 3 years. The two best teams they had were Kentucky of the early years of this decade, the ones with John Wall and Cousins and Brandon Knight and Anthony Davis and Michael Kidd-Gilchrist, against Texas, who had Kevin Durant and LaMarcus Aldridge. Now, if you've ever listened to me talk college basketball in this town, you know how much I think Rick Barnes is probably the one coach in America who has pissed away more talent than anyone in the history of the sport. And that's saying something, because there's been a lot of guys who has pissed away a lot of talent, including Coach Cal. But Rick Barnes is at the top of that list. Rick Barnes lost double-digit games with Kevin Durant. Okay? And DJ Augustine was on that team too. He's still in the NBA. You had one of the best three players in the world for the last 10 years and lost double-digit games. I'm sorry, I digress. But anyway, ESPN says those would be the two best teams if all recruits were required to stay at school for 3 years. Hard to disagree with the UK side, and heck, it's hard to disagree with the Texas side. College football, the grand poobah of preseason publications, the great Phil Steele has predicted Florida State will win the national championship this year. Gotta admit, I didn't see that one coming. Other teams in his top four, Alabama, of course, Oklahoma, of course, LSU, of course. The usual suspects. College football kicks off in 60 days, but for most sports fans in this town, it can't get here soon enough because it means one day closer to basketball season. North Carolina came out this weekend and said, hey, we're going to respond to the NCAA allegations against us in July. When were they told about these allegations? Wasn't it last July? Maybe before that. It took over a year. It took a year, maybe more, to respond to this? This has been going on for decades. Dude, Michael Jordan was in on this. Phil Ford was in on this. I can't go any further back in North Carolina basketball than Phil Ford, but God, this is the worst. A football player at Georgia was kicked off the team because he tried to steal a $30 pair of headphones. $30? How much do those Beat headphones run? About $200? $300? Those were some cheap headphones. I wear some really cheap headphones, but $30 for headphones and you're stealing them? If you're going to steal a pair of headphones, get some Beats. I'll tell you this, though. Mark Richt would have let him slide. The new coach, Kirby Smart, he won't. It's official, Art Briles will not come back to Baylor. The fact that they were considering letting him coming back after maybe a year suspension was maybe the stupidest thing I've ever heard in my life. Very sad. They finally came to their senses and told him to leave. Now, let's see where Art Briles lands. Let's see if he gets another job anytime soon. He shouldn't, but he will. Oh, good. Peyton Manning is back in the news. I love it. He came out over the weekend and said, I'm pulling for Brock Osweiler to win this year. In fact, I'm pulling for several teams. I'm pulling for Denver and Indianapolis and the Giants and Houston and Miami and Detroit. And all these teams that have connections to his past or his family or whatever. He left one team out, by the way. He left out the Bears and his former coach, John Fox, which just tells you how much he hated John Fox. But that's neither here nor there. So there you go, Peyton Manning. You want to be a great announcer? Go ahead and just root for half the teams in the league. Don't draw a line in the sand at all. Typical Peyton Manning jerkness, which is why he is at the head of the Mount Rushmore of jerks in sports. Jose Reyes, who was suspended for the first 2 months of the season, was released by the Rockies and now will go back to New York. Why was he suspended? He beat up his wife. But we have no video, so we can't kick him out of the league. If there was a video, I'm sure he'd never play again, a la Ray Rice. But Jose Reyes not only gets out of Colorado, now he goes to a contending team in the Mets. It's almost like he beat up his wife, got suspended, then gets to go to a better team. Doesn't seem right, does it? More Johnny Manziel crap. Now Manziel's dad says he hopes he goes to jail. Maybe that will clean him up. Manziel's lawyer is worried because he can't stay clean. That's not good. Then again, every time you hear these bad things, you also hear, oh, Manziel's working out. He plans on playing this year. Playing what? PlayStation? The closest way he'll come to playing football this year is if he enters a Madden tournament. By the way, the Cubs have been the best team in baseball all year, right? Not necessarily. They've lost 6 out of their last 7 games, and now the Rangers have 49 wins compared to the Cubs' 48. Quick, name 5 Rangers right now. Exactly. As an added bonus here on the bottom line, we have one weakness on this show, and it's watching Big Brother in the summertime. Because let's just face it, what else is going on in sports or anywhere? Bottom lines, Big Brother power rankings. Now, where else are you going to get this? Top three after Sunday night's episode, I'll go Tiffany 1, Michelle 2, Frank 3. Although I hate taking one of those players that gets another chance and comes back. But Tiffany and Michelle, that's your twosome to go to the end of this game. There's your Big Brother breakdown. By the way, that Jose guy, about as entertaining as anything I've seen on this show in the last 10 years. Enjoy him while you can, because it looks like he's gone Thursday. But still, anybody who calls himself a messiah and actually believes it, yeah, that's good television.
Greed is good.
Cash, cold, that's what I need.
And now with his picks for today's games, the man who's right 52% of the time, Smooth Jimmy Apollo.
Well, I don't know. Denver.
Woohoo! Denver! Yeah!
Winning's one of those rare commodities on earth that money cannot buy until you called me.
All right, it's Mac Daddy Stogie time. We talked about the Reds and the Cubs earlier. It's either Reds or nobody. I'll take nobody, but I do not fault you for taking the Reds tonight because you're getting a lot of value. You're getting the Reds at home, and you're getting a Cubs team that, let's just face it, they're not playing well right now. They've lost 6 of 7. But we'll go to the state of Missouri, St. Louis, and Kansas City. In Kansas City, both teams come in 39 and 35. Adam Wainwright for the Cards, 4.73. What happened to this guy? Against Danny Duffy of the Royals, 3.38. Cardinals making a little run. They stuck it to the Cubs early last week, sent the Cubs on this little tailspin that they've been on. On the road, Cards pretty good. 11 and 7 is an away underdog this year, and I'm getting the better pitcher in Wainwright. Last three starts, 2.29 ERA. So for my money, I've got the better team with the better and more proven pitcher in a good spot. Give me the Cardinals, plus 105, against the Royals in Kansas City tonight as your Mac Daddy Stogie pick tonight. And don't let that Cardinal closer carousel scare you away from taking them. They're actually better off with Rosenthal not pitching the ninth inning because he's been lousy for 6 weeks now. So Cardinals tonight, bullpen in better shape than it was last week. Let's smoke one by the ninth inning. And that's it for the Monday, June 27th edition of the Bottom Line Lexington Podcast. Thank you, as always, for listening. Make sure to follow us on Twitter at Bottom Line Lex and email us anytime, bottomlinelex@gmail.com. Thank you once again, and until next time, may the winners be yours.